The governor broke with tradition recently by soliciting lawmakers' opinions on what issues and bills should be considered in the 30-day session upcoming. Now, these even year shorter sessions are primarily designed to develop and finalize a budget, as you know, but the governor does have discretion to add other issues to the docket. Ms. Lujan Grisham has already said she plans to add legalizing cannabis to the agenda, as well as her proposal to offer free tuition to most college students and the creation of a permanent fund for early childhood education. That's a lot. Here to help us place odds on what makes the cut and what doesn't are this week's Line Opinion panelists. All of them have signed up to research this week's topics and offer their informed opinions. So first up, we welcome Line regular and attorney Laura Sanchez-Rave. Glad you're back here with us, not traveling around the country. And Julianne Grimm's here. She's editor and publisher of the Santa Fe Reporter, joins us this week as well. Also with us, Line regular and principal of the Garrity Group, that would be Tom Garrity. And last but certainly not least, our Line regular and public health consultant Michael Byrd is here. Thank you all for being here at the table. Now, many lawmakers say they have never been asked their opinions before a session, Julianne, and there's lots of ways to read into this. What's your initial take about why the governor is asking for solicitations this early?
I don't think there's anything wrong with trying to figure out what people want and what their priorities are.
Right.
This has certainly happened in an informal way, you know, throughout all of time.
Fair enough.
Absolutely. So getting those things written down, I'm a little curious as a journalist, are we gonna be able to get those records to review them? Is that something that's gonna be available? I think based on what we know right now about what's on the form, we should be able to get a look at those if somebody wants to. But I think it's a good way for the governor to sort of figure out where the big fight would be or where the consensus is. You know, and I think there's a little, some issues where it's obvious and some issues where it might be really helpful to find that out from a few legislators.
Right. Interesting point there, Michael. She's moving the clock up a little bit about decision making. No problem. It's an interesting tactic when you think about it.
Well, I think there's nothing wrong with trying something new. Just because it's never been done before doesn't mean she shouldn't try something. And I think people should be open to it. Let's, you know, I mean, you can always go back to where you were before.
That's a good point. So. Do you find that the things I mentioned in the opening, does it feel to you as too much in the 30-day? Is there a way to parse this down to get priorities sort of figured out? Because that feels like there's a lot of things she wants to try to do in this 30-day, and some of the legislators might not be able to move that quickly. Does she have to make a decision here?
I would think so. I mean, she's clearly, you know, has an activist sort of approach. And so, but obviously she wants to have people on board and make sure they're endorsing her and her ideas, and it's nice to see that she's willing to have a conversation about what the legislators are interested in and want to see move as well.
For real, Tom. When you think about it, everyone's going to be on the team if they choose to participate. No one can claim to be disenfranchised. No one can claim to be not heard beforehand. You see what I mean? There's an interesting tactic here. Especially the rural-urban divide, some folks feel in the rural parts feel they don't have the governor's ear. Now you can have the governor's ear. Interesting tactic there.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I mean, from a strategy perspective, it's quite fascinating because, you know, if you're a legislator, you know, you put down your ideas. But do you put down all of your ideas for the risk of having them potentially hijacked by the fourth floor or used against you later on? So is it a gift or
that
is it a Trojan horse? I don't know. But so I think it's kind of fun, you know, like Julianne had mentioned. I'd be very interested to see if these would fall under IPRA and if we'd be able to see who they would be able, you know, what different legislators are wanting to do and what they want to accomplish.
Let's cut back to what I asked Michael about. We got cannabis on the table, early childhood on the table. Can she fit all those things in?
Oh, well, that's really up to the legislature, but, you know, she can make the call as big as she wants. I think the big three are going to be pot, pensions, and PRC. So, you know, those are the big three that I think that she'll want to be able to have addressed during the session.
Sure, absolutely. What's your sense of this? First, the why of the ask, and then what are the results or the upshot of doing it this way?
Just to sort of circle back to the IPRA issue, the legislature has definitely not, they're exempt from IPRA.
But once they give it to the governor, that it becomes a little bit of a different game.
But it depends how they give it to him, to the governor's office. So, you know.
Well, let's pick that fight.
In any event,
love it.
Obviously, I'm more political strategist than journalist.
Yeah. Does it work for you? I mean, everyone's going to be on the table. I think another angle here is the governor may be trying to assess who wants to show up, basically, versus just show up and blow
really,
with the wind.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, I think it's really smart. I think it's smart to have the conversation early. Actually, this is, I know a lot of people think this is very early. It's actually not that early because you really have to start developing these ideas and, you know, figuring out who's going to be your sponsor and start, and things get filed in December. So you really, you're talking about a couple of months, not even a couple of months, a month at this point to really get that stuff down. And so I think it's smart for her to reach out in a formal way. I do think that it's been happening for a long time informally. I mean, I know that, Governor Richardson did that through his staff and relationships that he had with the legislators. But this is definitely a much more formal way of doing it. And I think it's good for her to get, especially with limited time in a 30-day session, to determine what kind of issues are out there and she can put onto the call. I do think I agree with Tom on those three issues. I think that among them, there, I think that some of them probably have more momentum than others. But those are definitely top issues. I mean, I think it's no different, though, than Martinez when she tried to, bring in third grade reading retention and immigrants' driver's licenses into a 30-day session.
Good.
So
good
those were
there.
Out there, issues. And I think that the governor's office obviously has a lot of the power to set the agenda, obviously, for a 30-day session. So it can be done. I think it just depends whether there's enough momentum.
Let me throw another issue on the table, red flag laws, Julianne. You know, the idea that that's been floating around as a potential 30-day session topic point as well. And I ask under that idea, a budget session, there's lots to talk about in a budget session. Lots, especially the budget situation we have now. We have all this money flowing in. There's going to be lots of decisions about how to spend it. Can we really accommodate a conversation about red flag laws?
I mean, the conversation that needs to be had, the next conversation about the red flag laws, it's a big one. And I think, we just saw on July 1st, New Mexico had some new law go into effect about people who are seeking orders of protection in the court in domestic violence cases. There is now a due process that allows the courts to order the seizure of weapons for people who are accused of domestic violence crimes. And that is new for New Mexico. That is something that the sheriff's departments and the city police departments and the state police are still really trying to get a handle on how they will handle it, the mechanics of all of that. Santa Fe Reporter just did a story where we were able to get lots of information from Santa Fe County Sheriff about it, but we've really gotten now conflicting information from the city police department about whether they're even complying with the law or not as it stands. So that's all to say that contemplating a 30-day session in which we would again change the gun laws and given the opposition to all of that, I just don't see that that's one that's really likely to, if it does end up on the session, I don't see it likely to really go anywhere this time around.
Yeah, that's a good point, too. I don't think you'd be alone on that. I've heard that from other folks, too. Let me go back to the cannabis situation, Michael. Again, we've had the governor formed a task force to go around the state and get some feedback, law enforcement, citizenry, all that kind of stuff about putting a proposal together. Governor likes it. Looks like she's going to kind of push this thing through. My sense is this is going to be a bit of a discussion about this. This is not exactly a slam dunk. So I ask again, at the risk of the budget being not fully discussed, are we giving up something by talking about these issues during this 30-day session? And can cannabis actually work in this capacity?
Well, I think there's a lot of loose ends still to in terms of this, the whole proposal and the way that it needs to get, I mean, at least from what I see in the paper, there's somebody always bringing up a new issue or a new concern. It remains to be seen what's going to happen. I don't know.
Yep.
Gene, I think it's really smart that they are, though, talking about starting that bill in the Senate this time around. So we sort of know that the House has this inclination. The House is likely to pass the thing again, but the Senate is where it's going to get hung up again. So I think it's good for the people of New Mexico. Let's not churn this through the House for the 30-day session only to have it die in the Senate. Let's see how the Senate feels about it this time and then go from there.
That's a key distinction. Thank you for bringing that in. That actually makes a lot of sense. Just swinging to the budget here real quick before a little bit of time we have left here. The idea that schools, you might have seen in the paper, schools are now under question about how they're using their money for that they've received as part of the moonshot. Going on here, Laura, I'll turn to you on this. Is that going to be a problematic part of the conversation in this upcoming session, do you think?
I think it will absolutely have to be part of the conversation.
Yeah.
I think that is a concern in terms of being able to utilize those additional funds appropriately,
right.
Efficiently. And the other issue, too, is the Yazzie case that's still mm-hmm. ongoing. And the plaintiffs there filed a motion this week dealing with that, asking the judge to, you know, reopen this to basically force the government to do something about it, the mm-hmm. state to do something about this. And really, I think a lot of critics and people on the plaintiff side of that case feel that not enough has been done.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there were obviously increases in teacher salaries, which mm-hmm. were sorely needed. There was increases in budgets. But did it specifically target the groups that were the plaintiffs in that case,
mm-hmm.
which are at-risk populations, mm-hmm. Native Americans, Hispanic, students with disabilities, very vulnerable populations that really need those additional resources? And so it sounds like even though there was additional funding,
mm-hmm.
the details of how they actually
right.
got used
right.
did
right.
not get fleshed out, and that needs to be part of the conversation.
And we talked about that at this table, as a matter of fact, when that money's, those
yes.
monies, didn't we, though?
Yes,
you were
we
here.
Did.
Exactly,
yes,
you're
we
right.
Did.
We got about a minute and a half, or a little bit less than that, on this. Go ahead and pick up on that as well. That's going to be impactful in this budget conversation, isn't it? It just seems to me that we took this early shot, now we're sort of backing up a little bit and saying, okay, hang on, we need to get some clarity here. So.
Well, it's clear that given the plaintiffs, and I mean, that it is an issue. They don't feel like the plan is addressing those populations
mm-hmm.
adequately,
mm-hmm.
and so it's not finished.
Mm. Good point. That's all the time we have on that one. But rest assured, we'll be talking more about that as we get closer to the 2020 session. Now, still ahead on this week, encouraging economic development here in Albuquerque while still protecting our historic neighborhoods.